o'clock. Starting today, we've obviously had some very sad news recently, losing Councillor Malcolm Sharp last week. And I just wanted to say, I know that from all of us in this room, we've lost a good colleague, a good comrade, and a good friend. And when I think about kind of the time that Mal has been here at Merseytravel over the past 3 years, I think his impact on the organisation has been really profound. If you think about how actually it was Mal that set up the scrutiny committee and the approach to scrutiny that we've got, that Ken's been able to take on to new heights. Whether it was Mal's involvement when he was lead member for customer and social responsibility, really championing what we've done with regard to customer forums on a roving model, and also as well being one of the key people along with Ron and Mary and Steve and others about championing the more affordable deal for young people that we've been able to deliver so far and will continue to drive forward on. Or whether it was in his role more recently as lead member for Rail and doing the work he's been doing on the long-term rail strategy and Rail North, or even more recently as vice chair and being a very sort of good sounding board and support and source of advice and guidance for myself. I know, you know, from this organisation perspective, we'll really miss Mal. However, I think the way that I'll certainly remember Mal most fondly is that he was a really ambitious man. And when I say that, I don't mean that ambitious for himself as a person. I mean that he was ambitious for the people he represented. He was really ambitious for Kirby, really ambitious for Knowsley, really ambitious for this city region. I wanted to make sure that we always got the best deal for everybody. And the way I'll remember him the most is actually making sure that we all continue to be as ambitious as Mal would want us to be. So I hope you can all join me now in just having a moment's silent reflection to remember our good colleague, comrade and friend, Councillor Mal Sharp. Okay, can I ask if we've got any apologies for absence?
Apologies, Councillor Dodd, I think Councillor Rowland as well, Chair.
Okay, and apart from that, I think we're all present and correct. The third item is just the usual declarations of interest, and that's just for me to remind us of the requirement that we need to make it. But either now or at any time during proceedings, there's any reason to flag up an interest that we may have. Fourth item is the minutes of the last meeting, and if I can move that the minutes of the last meeting that were held on the 10th of September, if those are approved, is a correct record?
That agrees.
Excellent. Item 5, Ken.
Thank you very much, Chair. I'm pleased that the contents of the Performance and Review Subcommittee on Merseytravel the 14th of September 2015.
Excellent. Is that agreed? Okay, item 6 then, a very significant item, as it's the intention to issue an OJEU notice for the procurement of rolling stock for the Merseyrail network. And John Foulkes is going to present this report.
Yes, thank you, Chair. This report, which you'll see, is seeking agreement of members to enter into a procurement process for a new fleet of rolling stock for the Merseyrail network. Obviously, this has been quite a long time in its gestation. It's been quite long and complex commissioning phase associated with this, but we're now at a point where we understand that the risks around the ageing capacity of the Merseytravel fleet, which have been well documented and understood, such that basically they can't last forever. So for the past 3 years we've been looking at how we can identify the best way to address this issue and to protect the network in the long term. The detailed analysis which has been undertaken by David Powell's team make it clear that the engineering risks of maintaining the current fleet beyond the next 5 years or so will just become too great, will become too costly to maintain, but probably more importantly, they'll start to bite in terms of the damage it could do to the local economy. Demand from passengers is forecast to increase over the next decade quite significantly. And the current fleet and the current timetable just won't be able to match that demand. New, faster trains with smarter interior design will bring that increased capacity that the network is going to require. We've identified a financial model that keeps the cost of the new fleet and the other associated works within the Merseyrail concession. It should be self-financing over the period, over the time that the rolling stock will be operational, and it keeps the costs away from the local taxpayer. It's a rail issue rather than a local tax issue. We believe the package we've identified also represents better value for money than alternative approaches which we've considered, principally the traditional approach of leasing rolling stock from a rolling stock company, a Roscoe. There's obviously risks associated with a project of this scale, which have been open within the business case and the report. A comprehensive governance and risk management approach will be adopted that will include the key third parties that are that will be instrumental in delivering this. So it's not just ourselves, it's very much Network Rail. Merseyrail Electrics clearly is the key partner in this, but also the power supplier for the network. As you know, Merseytravel is unusual in that we control the concession for the local rail network. This form of devolution has been very successful in delivering improvements to the network, making it, really shaping it to suit the city region's purposes. But with that devolution comes responsibilities, and you know, we do have a responsibility to make sure there's effective, appropriate rolling stock on the network. At this stage, what we're recommending, I think it's important to note, is that we move to a procurement exercise. We commence that procurement exercise in order that hopefully we can identify a successful bidder for the new fleet. The project team have used industry experts from across many disciplines to identify the anticipated costs of this project. We're confident that our financial model is robust. I should stress that at this stage there's no commitment to proceed other than to go to market. Further key decisions will be necessary before the organisation gets to a point where we'll be recommending a contract award. Therefore, the organisation isn't committing any resources at this stage beyond the direct cost of David and David's project team and the third parties that will engage with in terms of, you know, of getting through the procurement phase to a point of contract award, which will be the key decision, will be the contract award. So that said, that we'll be happy to answer any questions on the report, as will David. Stand back to you, Chair.
Thank you. If there's any questions or comments from Harry.
John, what are the risks if Network Rail is privatised, as it appears to be one of the objectives?
Well, the risks around the change in any change in governance with Network Rail, we would anticipate that any of their existing commitments would be novated to whatever new governance entity came into being. We have been very, very careful to work with Network Rail on developing a memorandum of understanding by which they will commit to facilitating the delivery of this project within the timescales that, you know, that the project identifies. I have to be open that that we provided quite a significant chunk of money to make that happen, because we don't feel that we want to be reliant on Network Rail's financial contribution to this project. Just the delivery contribution, we'll continue to work with them on the course of the project, but our memorandum of understanding would be that we will make quite a significant financial contribution to what is their asset, and in return they will ensure that the works that the project depends upon can be, you know, will be delivered. But it is a key project risk. I don't know if that answers your question or David, do you want?
Thanks, John. Yeah. Network Rail being privatised was the question. I guess the network we depended on, Network Rail, for the delivery on any of the initiatives that we undertake as an organisation, so I guess that risk is there anyway. We know they're an organisation under pressure, but we've worked very hard with them over the course of the last couple of years to get them to a place where now they are, they're aligned with our thinking. They're indicating that they're able to deliver what we need to in advance of the new trains turning up on the network, which is the objective I'm looking towards.
I'm quite satisfied with that. The only point I'd make, the reason I asked the question is, I take it that as part of the negotiations, that possibility now will be discussed with us to kind of reinforce the fact they said yes, and whether that happens or not, the number of memorandum of understanding.
Sorry, I've got Mark and then Ron.
Thanks, Chair. Similar vein to Harry's question in relation to Network Rail and those third parties. If worst came to worst and they weren't able to fulfil the requirements, what would we do? So if Network Rail had problems further down the road, what would our options be? How would we address any shortfalls in the works?
Well, we would hope that we'd be able to enforce the memorandum of understanding. The levers we have are hopefully legal, commercial and financial. It does remain, that reliance on Network Rail does remain a key project risk, though throughout the project will need to be managed. It's probably, I'll say it for the sake of simplicity, it might be oversimplistic, but it's the power supplier that Network Rail will engage in that's actually the critical party. The infrastructure demands of the new rolling stock are not exclusively, but principally to do with power supply to the network. It's not of the same nature as the Network Rail infrastructure projects that we've been reading about over the last few years, and more recently. It's not that type of project for Network Rail, which gives us some, gives us a quite high degree of comfort that we'll be able to adhere to that MOU that we'll have with them.
This is a point of clarification. My understanding is that there is other deliverers. Network Rail failed to deliver or can't deliver because of workload or whatever, or the government say not doing that, for hold on there going forward. There is a contingency in this, in the whole of the plan, that there is potential for other suppliers to provide that electrical work. It's not solely reliant upon this. I understand the memorandum and also the Network Rail, and that's being used, but it's not solely reliant on that. And that's based on my knowledge of going on this journey from day one with this project. So that needs to be clarified, if my recollection is correct, that while we would prefer Network Rail to be the vehicle we use, it's not reliant on them to deliver it if they fail to do that.
Yeah, so building on what John was saying, I think the first thing is we did write to the new chairman of Network Rail about our concern about all of Network Rail schemes, Trans Pennine all the way down through Foulkes and this project. So I think we'll still want to have a meeting with Network Rail at that level to make sure that they are fully committed. As John said, the work that Dane's team's been doing with at a more local level should lead to the MOU. So our preferred option is to deliver through Network Rail. Clearly, if that starts to go the wrong way because of changing governance or their just inability to deliver, we have already started partial discussions with them about is there a different way, and that's us funding directly either through the Department for Transport or directly to a supplier who can do the work. Experience says that's quite complicated and quite painful, but it is an option. As long as we've got early sight from Network Rail about their delivery, our preferred option at the moment is through the MOU. As you quite rightly say, Ron, there are a couple of other options that we've got in the background that we've done a bit of work on. But at the moment, all the effort is going into getting Network Rail to sign up to the MOU and then for them to commit at a senior level through their new team to deliver the scheme.
Yeah, I'm not going to talk about technical stuff, that probably won't surprise any of you. If I talk about people and the customer, you know, according to an independent economic assessment carried out by the Centre for Economic Business Research, a new fleet would lead to the creation of 1,000 jobs in the regional economy and provide a boost for the local economy of £70 million per annum. Not only that, I'd like to see Mrs. Jones, Mr. Jones, Baby Jones, all travelling on something decent, something that's up to date, and I'm not knocking the fleet we've got now because it's done a fantastic job in its time. But it's a bit like me, it's getting on, it's tired. It can't always be fixed. And, you know, for me, I think this is one of the best things I'll probably do in my time on Merseytravel, put my hand up and say, we've got to do this and we've got to do it quick.
No, absolutely. And it's all about providing a better transport system for local residents who want to work and play here. And Dave's team done a fantastic job in getting all the economic analysis and all the data. You know that we've already worked with passenger focus to get views of real people about what they want to see train system. We've got 100% commitment to continue to do that, so that we're producing trains that current and future users will want to do. Also going to work very hard with the suppliers to make sure that they're introducing the local supply chain into the delivery of these vehicles. We know these vehicles aren't going to be built on Merseyside, but there may well be parts of it or parts of the overall supply chain that can be done here. And also we're very keen for the suppliers to try and put in place long-term apprenticeships leading to full-time jobs in both the supply and delivery, but also the maintenance of these trains. So although it is about train, it's very much about the people, which are helping us to specify what they need, but also in the delivery of it and the ongoing maintenance of those trains. So it's very much not just a train project, but a people project as well.
Go on. Thank you, Chair. It's extremely sad to not be a member on this department of our business. It saddened us all a great deal, and I know that Mal will be saying how excited he was about this project. But I find it exciting, and I think in many ways we get the technical side, the legal side of performances. And it does explain to us that there are a lot of asks that we want to be able to make the European rulings that we have. There's a limitation to that. But I feel that as we go out to the very excited about this, and I'm sure we've got a strong team backing this one up, and as elected members, it's something that we want to be a part of to see that for the future, it's a meeting for the people that are coming along, not yet born, and will be using this system, that we make the right decisions as we go along on this. And I hope it will be a testimony to all the people involved, including elected members,
John, David, John, answer the
points that thank you, Gordon. Yes, there are innovations in the web industry. I know it's an industry that's been around for well over 150 years, but technology does move on. I'll be making sure that we get the best out of the bidders. We want to get the best bidders in the world, and we want to make sure that all their best ideas are made available to us. I'll make sure that that's done through the procurement process. I've been designing the tender documents.
Any further questions or comments? Ken?
I just think one comment, Joe. I mean, I've been banging the drum, I don't know how long now, whether we're going to move forward, whether we're going to happen. So I think it's congratulations to officers, Dave, everybody else who's put this family together, and now we're taking the first step towards, you know, not for the number. Congratulations to all.
No, I think we'd all agree with that entirely, Ken. We've been working on this, haven't we, for a long time, because we're very conscious to make sure we get it right, and it is the next stage in a journey that's still going to take another 5 years, likely before we get brand new trains arriving in the Liverpool city region. But I think we also all recognise that do nothing is not an option in all of this. Whilst, as Mary rightly said, the 507, 508 fleet we've got has served us really, really well over the past few years, we do know, because of their age, they won't continue to be that way. And yeah, the only practical and economic and cost-effective option is to buy a new fleet of trains. I think it's important, as John had mentioned, and as the questions from Harry and Mark have picked up, that with a project of this nature, there will be risks. We know there are risks. We've identified those risks, and our eyes are wide open about those, and how we are going to mitigate and manage those risks. And I think it's really important that that's a central part of this project. Another key element is the pounds, shillings and pence, how are we going to pay for them. I know the detailed work on the business case has really kind of underlined that, and the most important part of all of that is that these new trains will not fall on the levy to the district councils, i.e. a council taxpayer. And I think that's really important, that's been underlined as one of the key principles of the project accordingly. But there's also, as Gordon says, some really exciting prospects in all of this, whether it's the kind of economic information that sort of Mary suggested about how the new fleet of trains will help power our local economy, all the way through to kind of how a new fleet of trains will give a much better offer to the travelling public and actually kind of deliver much more for the people of the city region. So just like Gordon, just like Ken, just like Ron, just like everyone who's spoken and everyone in the committee, I'm equally excited. But we know that because it's the next stage on the journey, there's more hard work to go ahead. And as Ken had said, let's pay tribute to the officers for what they have done thus far. But at the same vein, we know there's another 5 years and beyond of more hard work, so let's get it right. So with all of that in mind, if I can move the recommendations in paragraph two, if those can be approved.
Agreed.
And Mr. Powell, go and buy some trains.
Thank you.
Excellent. Okay, item number seven is Merseytravel Final Accounts for 2014-15. And Dave's going to present this for us. John, sorry.
I'll do this one, Chair. these papers represent the final accounts of Merseytravel. Merseytravel, as you know, but just for clarification, as an organisation now sits within the Liverpool City Region Combined Authority. These accounts also form part of the group accounts that were presented to the Combined Authority last Monday. They were also presented and accepted by the Merseytravel Executive last week, and they've also been in draft form to the Liverpool City Region Combined Authority Audit and Governance Committee in July, where they were picked apart and challenged quite robustly. The accounts have now been audited, and we're pleased to report that
the auditor's opinion has been unqualified. The opinion isn't just about the accuracy of the accounts, although that's very important. It's also an opinion on the value for money the organisation provides and our approach to risk and to corporate governance. The accounts themselves required a number of adjustments as a result simply of changes in accounting policy in respect of bus stations. It's quite detailed stuff. This was undertaken by our account staff correctly, but the auditors also required a revaluation. This revaluation to be reflected in prior years as well to aid the user in comparing them. As a result of this, there were some quite complicated changes that needed to be effected, but it's important to stress that not a penny more or less was spent by the organisation as a result of those changes that needed to be made, nor was there any impact on any of our cash balances as a result of it. It was a technical adjustment. In terms of governance, the auditors have stressed within the report you'll see the progress that's been made in the three years since the peer review, and have raised no issues in our treatment of any of the risks that they've identified at the start of the audit process. They've raised a number of issues related to how our finance team worked with the auditors in the course of the final accounts process and the rest of the year, which we're really happy to accept. What you will see is one recommendation, quite a significant recommendation around Merseytravel and its audit and governance arrangements. You'll also see that Merseytravel itself has raised that in its own annual governance statement. So it's not something that was new to us. It's part of a continuing journey, really. As you'll be aware, in 2014-15, Merseytravel continued to use the ITA's previous audit governance committee in the same way as it did before the combined authority came into being, even though the combined authority had its own audit governance committee. And we were quite happy to do that. But what you'll also be aware of is that it became apparent that there were constitutional issues with this approach as a result of the change to a CA. Basically, the key issue here is that Merseytravel as an executive is a separate statutory body under the 1968 Transport Act. So it's quite a technical issue. But what that meant was effectively the CA's Audit Governance Committee and the ITA's Audit Governance Committee were duplicating each other. And you'll know clearly that ITA's committee, as was disestablished at the AGM earlier this year. There was always the understanding that in doing so, the Merseytravel executive would have to put in place its own separate arrangements, which we've now done so. The auditors have raised that in the report. We've worked with the auditors very closely to make sure that what we intend to do is good practice. Very helpfully, that good practice is captured by the CITFA standards, the CITFA public sector internal audit standards, which we are putting in place measures that will mean that we're fully compliant with those, as will be the combined authority. So the two statutory bodies will each be fully compliant with the relevant guidelines in that area. So we've already, as an executive, formally agreed to recruit what will be a suitably qualified and independent chair to an executive's audit governance committee. I don't think we'll call it that because we might confuse matters, but it'll effectively be that, and a further independent member as well. So having two lay members or independent members will mean that we're fully compliant with best practice in that area. It's important that this committee complements the work of the CA's Audit Governance Committee and dovetails well with it without duplicating its work. So we'll work closely with Councillor Carr to make sure that the relationship between the two is effective and that reporting ensures that the CA's Audit Governance Committee, which is clearly the one that provides the democratic oversight through elected members, is kept fully informed of the activities that the corresponding committee for Merseytravel. Another point which you'll see in the report is that an objection has been raised by an elector, and That's a process that's open to any elector in any of your districts. Some of you may have already have experience of this within districts. If an objector effectively believes that an item of account is unlawful, he can raise that, or she can raise that, or they can raise that with the external auditor, who then is duly obliged to investigate that and close out that investigation before they can formally close the audit. Now, that investigation is pending, and it's probably not appropriate for me to go into too much detail, but the objection that has been raised is about an item of account from 1992-93. So it's about an issue that's 23 years past. The auditor has got to go through due process and close that out one way or the other before they can close the audit. What I will say is this issue has been raised previously and has been audited, and you know, it's about an internal transfer of funds between two Merseytravel services. So it's not yet resolved. We're very confident in our ability to explain why that's happened, even though very, very few of us were there at the time. We think it's quite clear that the organisation didn't behave improperly, but we'll have to see what the auditors believe before we formally close it out. So with that, just present to you the audited accounts.
Thanks, John. Before I open it up to questions, just on that last point you made about the objection, I appreciate why we can't go into too much detail at this moment in time, because it's still being dealt with. Once it is dealt with, obviously we can bring that back and give a background story to it, because obviously it seems like there's an issue that has been addressed, but it's perhaps been raised for different reasons. So yeah, perhaps if we can bring it back at the next committee so everyone can get the full story, because then that'd be very useful in terms of public accountability. Now I've got questions. I've got Ron, Tony.
We did investigate a number of alternatives. The first one primarily to stay with the arrangements that we previously had, because they were working quite well for the organisation. Well, not quite well, very well for the organisation. So it wasn't with any relish that we needed to change the arrangements. We looked at, we debated the inclusion of elected members, but as it keeps coming back to that separate statutory position that Merseytravel has as an executive, as a PTE, means that the relevant legislation, we know more than I do, precludes elected members from being part of that executive and an audit and governance committee. committee, we also looked at whether we could have, rather than lay members, people, representatives from the districts at an officer level. Well, then we encounter difficulties then around independence, and the city standards are very clear that it needs to be independent. Given that the district's fund us through the levy, there's issues there around that independence. We even looked at, whether we could include members of Merseytravel staff that were not members of the executive, but again, quickly you run into issues around independence. And, you know, working with our auditors and working within the CIFA standards, and also looking at what other bodies have done that are captured within these standards, in health and in police, fire, we don't feel that there is an alternative to the organisational solution that we're proposing, or that we're not proposing, because Merseytravel has an executive approved this yesterday, so that we could actually go out and start the process of bringing in the lay members that we quite badly need in order to show that there's some compliance this year.
Okay, thanks for that, John. Can I just ask though that, as you mentioned as well, that you work very closely with Tony and Israel, who's the chair of the Combined Authorities Audit Committee, and the establishment of this to make sure we actually get the right model, which gives us maximum scrutiny and accountability on the issues and in consideration. So we can make sure that's minuted and carried out accordingly. Gordon, sorry.
Thank you very much, Chair. It's just on the explanatory forward to the accounts. There's three points in that which I think on page 7 I'd like to just say I'm very pleased to see in it. I'd like it to be continuing that, John, if you would, because I think it's important to us. And I don't think the Chair would not expect me to comment on the protecting environment by reducing the carbon emissions, which is my normal comments. I also feel that in developing new forms of smart ticketing, we've come a long way from where we were, but I think we've got a long way to travel in terms of being able to tie in with the visitor economy and be smarter and better than that with apps and moving things along. But I think we've got to take it at the right stages, but that's something I'd like to see being moved forward. And I think importantly that in the past we've heard stories about companies that have suffered from cash flow, and it's very good to see in the trade payables how well we've done to make sure we made payments to people within the 30 days. I think it has been an effect on businesses which can't be underestimated in the past.
Thanks for including those points in the report, and I hope they continue to be very good. That's good. Any further questions or comments? Okay. In that case, can I move that the final accounts of Merseytravel for 2014-15 as submitted be noted? That's agreed. Item 8 is the Quarter 1 Corporate Plan Performance and Financial Monitoring Report, and can show us.
Perhaps this report is presenting an overview of corporate and operational performance for Q1 15-16, and provide an indicator to any key issues to future performance during the year. The performance team gather, collate and present performance information for each quarter. If there are any specific questions around activities, I'll happily find out the answers for you from the relevant service areas that is available for myself. The quarterly performance monitoring report includes the following elements: performance against corporate plan priorities for Q1, performance against the 7 key performance measures, and it provides an overview of results for financial monitoring for Q1 and highlights any key issues for the forthcoming Q2 monitoring period. Today we'll focus upon performance against corporate priorities and highlight the KPM status. All the updates around enabling themes are included within the main body of the report for your information, and details of the KPMs are summarised in Appendix 1. We're no longer using the RAGBI rating that was used in the previous financial year. This year we're following a RAG rating system, an and this will be applied to all future corporate performance reporting processes. The approved definition of RAG is red, means that it's behind target and will not be delivered, forecast not to be delivered or not delivered. Amber is behind target but will be delivered, and grey is delivered or scheduled to be delivered. A brief narrative is also provided in the report. It's worth noting that there's regular performance discussions between directors and heads of service and managers and teams as part of the performance management framework used within Merseytravel. The performance team meet with directors each quarter to support the processes as well. So if we look quickly at the KPMs, we can see that KPM 1, affordability, is for monitoring purposes only. This highlights the motoring costs have not risen very much since the base year, and can be seen to be more affordable in certain instances when compared to bus and rail fares. The indicator is updated annually, but it's also worth noting that Merseytravel strives to get a better offer to customers using public transport. KPM 2 relates to patronage. This is green. Tunnels and ferries patronage remain on target, and it's worth noting the patronage on bus and rail is for monitoring purposes only. Reliability status is amber. Reliability in supported bus services and Northern Rail has experienced some issues, but are expected to improve for the next quarter. The fourth KPM is punctuality. This too is an amber. Punctuality and support bus services has underperformed due to driver problems which have been addressed. KPM 5 is safety. This is a new indicator and it's for monitoring purposes only. The Travel Safety Partnership uses the data from surveys and incident reporting to improve the passenger experience. This is the first reporting of safety statistics and targets have not yet been set for this financial year. KPM 6 is customer satisfaction. It's 2 is an amber. There's been a rise in bus service satisfaction and Merseytravel satisfaction remains high also. KPM 7 is to connectivity to and within the city region. This is for monitoring purposes only and remains unchanged. So I'll now summarise performance against each of the corporate priorities. Corporate priority 1 is about providing professional advice, guidance and support to the continued development of the Liverpool City region. The status is green. It's made up of 6 activities, 3 of which are amber and 3 are green. This priority is largely on track and includes the development of PAM LCR prioritisation mechanism for transport, and other activities have begun. This aims to maximise the potential impact of resource for economic growth. Moving on to corporate priority 2, which is improving connectivity through leading and developing strategic transport initiatives linked to the LCR growth plan and wider regional and national strategy. This is coming out as a green. It's made up of 7 activities in total, 3 are amber, 4 are green. Again, we see this is largely on track and it includes the receipt of the Northern franchise admissions, involvement of the Chief Exec and Deputy Chief Exec in the early stages of Transport for North. This has been very beneficial. And the long-term rail strategy becoming embedded within Merseytravel's capital programme. If we move on to the third corporate priority, to develop and deliver a comprehensive bus strategy for the city region as part of a multimodal transport approach, this is also green. This corporate priority is made up of one strategic activity, which encompasses 3 specific tasks. These are all on track and